They've won Tonys and Oscars and Emmys and Grammys. There's no red carpet because they're home in their jammies. From Melrose Place to Broadway to Janeway and her crew, let Seth and James bring all the stars to you.
Anywho,
they're entertaining everyone, so who's gonna grouse? Just sit right back and you'll hear some tales on Stars in the
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Stars in the House. I have to lower my chair here.
I feel like this moved.
Wait, it did because I was. Oh no! You're gonna start moving
Move
it.
Over to you.
Okay. A little bit closer.
Hi, guys. This is the fundraiser we've been doing for the Actors Fund since everything shut down, and we're actually coming up to our 1 year anniversary.
Yes, we are.
We began March 16th, two shows a day, and we're gonna have a big anniversary week. And if you don't know what the Actors Fund is, James. Why don't you explain it?
It is, as BB North would say, a human services organization. She doesn't say it that slow. A human services organization that's for basically every professional in the arts in the United States, no matter what that is, on stage, backstage, doesn't matter the medium. It doesn't, by the way, the income threshold is quite low. It isn't like you have to be a professional who has made $80,000 a year. Anything like that. But basically, they are there to help people in this great time of need, whether it's paying rent, health insurance, food, utilities.
You just go to them. You see, like, here's my bill for my rent. And they're like, here's the money for the rent. I mean, it's direct financial assistance. And they're always, you know, being used constantly. And of course, now it's been crazy since everything began.
Yeah. By the way, I don't know if I've ever said this, but I lived in New York. This actually ties in because we're celebrating William Finn's birthday, which happens to be the same day as this one here, February 28th. We're doing it a little bit early because I'm doing a surprise birthday for Seth. He knows it's his birthday. And when he knows that we're going to do something on Stars in the House, but he doesn't know whom I've invited. It all ties into the Actors Fund because I moved to New York twice, once in 1998 and the very first off-Broadway show I saw it was a new brain. And it's one of those things, and I figured out the date, Seth. It was, I wish the stage manager, if the stage manager of a new brain is watching and has like the sheet of who was in that night or that day, it was the matinee of Sunday, July 12th, 1998. It was my first week in New York, the first Sunday in New York.
I'm almost positive I was conducting.
Wow.
Because I think I did every Sunday in July because Ted was gone and Steve Freeman was. I'm almost positive.
And we didn't know each other. We didn't know each other. I'm pretty sure that because it was, by the way, I say I got spoiled because I thought every off-Broadway show would be as amazing as that.
No, ma'am.
And I was wrong. It's like actors coming to New York and they get their first gig, like the first audition. And like everyone's going to be like that. Yeah. No, not every off-Broadway show is like a new brain basically everything that Bill Finn has written. But I was so blown away. I believe that day, Norm Lewis, Mary Testa.
Norm is marking. Kristen, so it was a matinee. We'll talk to him about it.
Kristen Chenoweth. I mean, I don't remember who was in that day, but I was just blown away. And it was in the new house theater, right? The one downstairs at Lincoln Center. So I lived in New York for a few years, moved away back to Texas after 9/11. And I came back in 2006. And basically the job that I had kind of went away literally as soon as I moved here. And this is a couple of months before I met Seth, and I went to the Actors Fund for help because I needed help literally to pay my utilities bill.
Wait a minute. We've been doing the show for a year and you're always like, a lot of people have used the Actors Fund and you never said, and by the way, so have I? You're literally laying this on me now at places?
Well, I thought it was appropriate, you know, moving to New York and Bill Finn's birthday.
Wow, and they paid your utilities?
Yeah,
that's what they do. You just go to them, you're like, I can't pay this and they'll give you money. So listen, since we've raised $700,000 around.
Yes.
And this is not from like crazy giant grants from like any organizations. It's just been amazing viewers that sent us money and we read the donations. They send like $5, $10, $25. So if you can help donate, and you know, we usually read letters to say how the Actors Fund is helping. And
it really
does make a difference. And someone actually posted here just one little thing about it. Hi, Seth and James. The Actors Fund has been helping my darling friends during the, I assume that means pandemic, during a delicious panini. During the pandemic, so much, what a wonderful cause. So listen, if you can donate, and the minimum is $5, that's it, the website takes $5, but anything up from there too. You go to starsinthehouse.com, and then you're going to get a receipt. Forward your receipt to donations at starsinthehouse.com, and then we'll have one of our stars read it. Michael Rupert will read it as Marvin. Perhaps he'll slap Wizard in the process. We'll see. So the point is, you forward the donation, starsinthehouse.com. No, donation at starsinthehouse.com. You could also text Fund 2020 to 56512 to make a donation.
Wait a minute. You still have to look down at the scrolling banner?
You know, it's weird.
You don't have the memorized?
I can never memorize that number right now.
Is it one of those things like you know a song really well, but if you put the lyrics in front of you, you'll look at the lyrics?
Or the opposite.
Even if you don't need to?
When I was doing Grease on Broadway, I was playing it for 2 years and my music fell down for 1 second. I was like, I don't know this song. I literally had to memorize, but I was like, how does Summer Nights go? I've literally been playing it for 2 years. So anyway, whatever.
Wait a minute. Before we bring on the birthday boy, We can bring him on. I want to know, when did you first meet him?
Well, we'll talk about it at Places.
Okay, so let's bring him on. It is Places.
All right, so please welcome, not since Martin Short really goes by Marty, William Finn, but nobody calls him William. Everybody calls him Bill Finn. Here he is, the birthday boy himself, Mr. Bill Finn. Black screen. Wait, Bill, what is with your Wi-Fi? So,
David
God.
David isn't in today. Oh, I'm starting to come in. Oh,
one,
there he
two,
is.
Three. Bill, the hell's happening?
Hello.
Hi, Bill.
Happy birthday, Seth.
Happy birthday, Bill.
Yeah.
We share a birthday. Me, Bill Finn, Bernadette Peters, Brent Barrett, Kelly Bishop, Tommy Toon. February 28th, the best. Bill, your blank face, I don't know if you're frozen or just your signature blank face. It's hard to tell.
Signature.
See?
So Seth, how did you meet?
I met Bill because Jason Robert Brown kindly asked me to be his assistant on A New Brain, the very first reading at the Public Theater with Michael Rupert and Greg Edelman and Liz Larson. And I've been obsessed with Bill Finn for years, so I freaked out getting to do A New Brain. It was one of the best experiences of my life ever. Billy, are you uptown on the Upper West Side in your apartment? Is that where you are right now?
I'm in Williamstown, Billsville. That's true.
Yeah, we got to cut. Okay, I'm going to start this up by bringing on two of your oldest friends. You guys have been working together since the 70s. I've got to hear all those early amazing stories because we're going to try to touch on every single show tonight if we can, although we're not going to be able to get to every single show, but almost every single show. So please welcome your two old pals, the lovely, her microphone is not working, Ms. Alison Fraser.
Hi, Alison.
Hi, Al.
Hi,
hello,
Alison.
Hey, Billy. Happy birthday. And it's Seth, happy birthday.
Thank you. And the other lady that started it all with you, Ms. Mary Testa.
Hello, Mary Testa.
Hello.
Hey, Mary. How you
hello,
doing?
Hello, Alison. I'm good. Hey, Bill.
First.
Happy birthday, Bill. Happy birthday, Seth.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mary.
Hi, Mary.
Mary, you
Hi.
Get the lighting. You get the lighting award tonight. The lighting is on point.
I know my shit.
Yes, queen. Okay, so we have to hear about the beginnings. How did you guys hook up?
Alice and I went to the same high school, and I saw her singing after I graduated. I saw her singing in the school show when I came back once, and I called her and said, you have a great voice, you want to sing with me.
Allison, did you know who he was? Because he was like the high school musician.
Yeah, he was famous in high school. He was sort of the star of the drama department and the competitive speech team. He was a legend. He also put together these incredible shows with hundreds of people. It's 70 now. And he would write the theme song to it. And he was a legend. So when
I didn't put it together. Jerry Dyer did.
Well, you and Jerry Dyer put it together.
I didn't put it together.
All right. You know what? I wasn't there then because he's a few years ahead of me. He was gone from high school by the time I went into high school. But he was a legend. And when he actually called me up after seeing me sing a really inappropriate song.
Stormy Weather, she sang.
What high school girl should sing Stormy Weather? Come on.
It's a classic.
Well, yeah, we
all were in high school. Please. Hilarious.
But I thought somebody was putting me on. I thought it was my boyfriend, John D. Savino.
Everyone disappeared.
The Bill fan. And I said, come on. But it was Bill. And we started singing together. Another woman called Joni Bartels, a great singer, who's in Australia now. And she's a wonderful, wonderful children's artist right now. She does a lot of song for kids. And we started singing in a little trio at like synagogues and town parks. And we did.
They had great voices.
Yeah, it was fun. We had a good time.
What town was this? Natick?
Natick, Massachusetts.
And Mary, how did you meet Bill?
I was in a production of Antigone in college. I believe I was a sophomore. And Bill, they were hiring Bill to do his a show called Scrambled Eggs. We had a 10-show season. We had a Rockefeller grant. And we did a 10-show, all-new play, new musical season. And Bill's show was one of the shows of the season. And we did this thing. Antigone was not a musical, but we did this big circle. And I was sort of in the chorus. And we had to sort of make musical sounds. And Bill, they asked who Bill wanted in his musical. And he said, I want her.
Just based on you kind of just making it up on the spot, what you were doing?
No, I wasn't making it up on the spot. It was something that was rehearsed, but it was not really singing. It was just sort of intoning.
I see. It wasn't like a whole song. You weren't auditioning.
No.
It was singing and she was great.
What? What did he say?
He said you were singing and you were great.
I think there's a bit of an echo with Bill.
Wait, yeah. I'm trying to think where the echo is coming
from.
It's
Bill's.
Okay, hold on. I'm going to see where the echo comes from. I'm going to mute you for a second. Mary, talk for a second. Let me hear if the echo's coming from you.
I don't think it's coming from me.
No. Never heard, Bill. Never seen a better picture and heard better,
heard
sound.
Better sound.
Thank you.
Fraser, let me hear you talk.
Hello, hello, hello. Is there an echo?
No, just nice resonance. So, Bill, turn down your volume. It could be the volume of whatever you're listening to. I know you're deaf, but turn it down a little bit. Okay, so these are like three up-and-comers out of town. Did you guys all move to New York to together, like Three's Company?
We didn't plan on moving together, but we all were in New York around the same time. We were young, and we all just started working together.
So please tell everybody, because of course I've heard you tell many times, but James doesn't know, about going to Bill's apartment and having him like experiment with songs with you guys.
Alison.
Well, we would go up to Billy's apartment on the Upper West Side when the Upper West Side was a little bit dangerous, and we would be there late at night. Oftentimes, and we would be singing with Bill and harmonizing and putting on descants, and it was a load of fun. It really was. We started working on the song cycle that would ultimately become In Trousers, Mirror. Yeah. And what did we do to make sure that
we'd have to clean his apartment, because it was a disgusting hole. We'd have to give him massages, neck massages while he was sitting at the piano.
And we had to chip in for really cheap wine and grapes.
Yes, and grapes, wine and grapes and some cheese.
You were singing his songs.
We were.
And giving it to you.
That's right. It was a lovely thing. It was a dazzling experience.
Yeah, it was wonderful.
But how did talk about when you finally gave that little presentation in his apartment? Isn't that what sort of started everything?
Yeah. Yeah, we did a couple of them, but Ira Weitzman happened to be at one. And Ira said, and he was working at Playwrights Horizons at the time, and he was like, this is great for Playwrights Horizons. So we did. I never remember the exact year. Was it like 78, 79?
I think it was probably 77.
77. We did a upstairs when it was a smaller theater with Bill playing Marvin and
brilliantly too.
Yes. And then they decided to move us down to the main stage, and that's when Chip came in. Wow.
But Mary Testa, where did you guys get the chairs for the presentation?
Synagogue. Remember?
Oh, did we get them there? I didn't even remember. Yeah.
Yes, I got them.
Yeah.
Really got them.
Wait, Bill, you walked into a synagogue and you were like, hey, Rabbi, I don't understand. How do you get chairs from a synagogue?
I said, hey, Rabbi, I'm a big Jew, and I need some chairs for presentation. Can I take some chairs? And he said, sure.
And that worked.
I recognize you, one of us. Take the chairs.
So then you guys
would you ever give them back?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So you guys get Playwrights Horizons. Can you talk about, first of all, to me, what's so cool is, did Alison and Mary, did you guys know this music was so forward? I mean, it was very, it wasn't.
Listen, we were involved. We were all working together. Like, this is our taste. This was our jam. This was what we liked to do. So, you know, while Bill wrote the music, we were very much involved with harmonies and things like that. It's like
you can imagine
they weren't just slouches on the side, you know.
Didn't you think it was just the coolest thing that you were part of, like, a brand new sound of Broadway?
I did.
Yeah, because
I never had any doubt that we would be ascendant.
We knew that it was.
We knew it was special.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, we sort of devoted ourselves to Bill.
Yeah, totally.
We hitched our wagon to that star.
I'm going to play a little, Mary, of that song. It's such an earworm. You just hear it once, you don't want to keep singing it. And also, you know, you're doing all these riffs, and it was definitely kind of early on Broadway or off Broadway to have riffs. I appreciate that, too, that it's riffing in the 70s, which is relatively new. And the harmonies are so beautiful. Let's listen to this.
That's what our hero found. Nothing is for nothing, and a new land is a new land to explore. Not just paths you can trace. I'm talking mountains and space.
So great. So catchy, aww, man.
Sweet.
Oh, so wonderful. So, Bill, were you thinking this is it? I've made it. I'm at Playwrights Horizons. Was that your, you know, when we were young, we think like that's the end of the road. Did you think this is the big deal? Did you think it's a stepping stone?
Stepping stone.
What was your ultimate goal back then?
To rule the world.
Broadway.
Broadway. So Broadway's your goal, but you're at Playwrights. Please tell everybody the time you guys rehearsed, because I'm a little fascinated by this.
11 to 3, I think.
Yeah, 11 p.m. to 3 in the morning.
It was 12 to 4. It was 12 to 4. We got the midnight slot. Yep.
But that was when we were upstairs, not when we were. That was the first production.
Yeah, the first.
Not when we were main stage.
Yeah.
But how did you earn a living if you're rehearsing from 12 to 4? When do you go to sleep? When do you wake up? And when do you have a day job?
We had jobs. You know, we had jobs we had to do. We had to do it. We were 21. We were 21 years old. So, you know, come on. You can do anything when you're 21.
How scary was it being on 42nd Street at midnight?
Or 4 a.m.?
All the homeless people knew Mary.
No, they did not. Reason.
They absolutely did.
No, that's not true at all. It was scary. The street was scary, but you know, we always stayed together. We didn't travel by ourselves. We always stayed together.
Did we actually take subways at 4 o'clock in the morning?
I probably took cabs. I've always taken cabs. You know, I was working as a waitress, so I was making some dough.
And you know, developing the role of Trina Allison, did you? You know, I know this is a bizarre question, but did you know you were developing this character that was going to be like for decades and decades played by so many different people?
That's a hilarious question. No, I really didn't. I just thought of it as me. I really did. I thought, well, he's writing this for me. And it was mine while it was mine. And now it's other people's. And I'm so happy that there are so many other incredible Trinas out there. I think they're all amazing.
And Billy, why in trousers? Why the story of Marvin and all these people? What was that based on?
Nothing. There are parts of my life, and then I made up part of it. You know, I was just trying to write something that would get attention.
But how do you understand at such a young age? I mean, it's such a new concept. Gay liberation was so new. Like, I mean, were people even out in those days around you? Like, what was the gay scene like in the 70s?
People were out.
What'd you say?
It was wild.
Yes,
in the
people
70s.
Were out.
Yeah.
People were out back then, huh? But like in the business, they were out. I mean, I just feel like it was so, it was still before.
know.
Wait, you know the 70s, don't you?
Well, I know what you mean, like in terms of, yes, there were bathhouses and stuff, but like it wasn't part of everyday conversation, like a guy leaving his wife because he's gay. I mean, it was the stories, not told.
The in-trouser story you're talking about.
That's right. What I mean, yes. Yeah. I mean, I know there was some gay action going on. Didn't people say to you, just write about a farm? Like, no one's going to buy this show about, like, you know, psychiatrists and gay people. I mean, weren't they trying to tell you to write something more normal?
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure they told Rogers and Amherst when they were writing Oklahoma to write about normal people.
Yeah. You know, he's an artist. He did what he did.
I love it, though. It's so, because it's so not turning a famous movie into a musical. It's so just, you all three of you were like, we're just doing what we really enjoy, and other people enjoyed it. It's very groundbreaking and inspiring.
Yeah, thank you. That's nice of you to say.
Right. I just love it. And Alison. Yeah, you could just tell Alison was, by the way, the first person to do Breaking Down, which I think people always forget because it became so big in the 90s. Yep. But this is Alison's song. I have some of it. Listen how great she is on this.
Three thoughts the fun we've had, and one fact does emerge. I played the foolish clown, the almost virgin who sings this dirge is on the verge of breaking down. Breaking up is my family. The only thing that's breaking up is my family, but me. I'm breaking down, down.
Yes.
That was not on the record.
No, unfortunately.
No, actually, it's on the CD of In Trousers because Bruce put it on there. Yeah.
Oh, it's so good. I got to go, I was telling Alison, I got to go to that Falsettos reunion of Playwrights Horizons. I'd never seen you do it, and oh my god, it was such a brilliant performance. I mean, Bill, how does it feel that the show just keeps living on all these years later, that it's so not of its time? I mean, it's so universal.
Falsettos?
Well, the whole trilogy, people are obsessed with.
Yeah. Nice. You know, you think you're writing, it's nice. You don't, it's nice.
Ship, I have a question.
Yes.
Do we all get to stay on when everybody else comes on?
Would you like to? You can.
Yeah. Then
you know what? Then let's do it. Then I'm going to bring on
it right now.
The next two clowns. I'm going to bring on Marvin and Marvin. So.
And one of them is in sepia tone.
Yes. Let's have the Marvin that many people know, the fabulous Michael Rupert. Hi, Michael.
Hey, guys.
And the Marvin.
Happy birthday, everybody.
Happy birthday, thank you, me and Bill. And the Marvin that became Mendel. He was also in sepia tone, Mr. Chip Zien. Hi, Chip.
Hello. Hi. Hi-ho. Billy, happy birthday. Seth, happy birthday.
Thank you, Pisces. Chippy, you were there at the beginning, too. How did you hook up with Bill Finn? Did you audition?
Yeah. I was so moved, like, hearing you guys, Mary and Alison, sing that stuff. I wish I weren't this old and we could do it all over again, because it was amazing. I was on my way to Los Angeles. I was going to give up on New York. I think it was 1978. And I got a call from my agent saying, where are you? I said, I'm in a cab. I'm halfway to JFK. And he said, well, I've got this great show. People think it's really cool. Called In Trousers, and can you come back and don't go to LA? Turn around. And I went home, and I did, it was a whim, and there was a cassette that they had sent to my apartment, which was really amazing. And I listened to it, and I thought, like, this is unbelievable, you know? So that was how I became aware of it. And then I had to go and audition for Billy, and I knew a lot of the other guys auditioning for Marvin.
Wait a minute, Chip. You know, you hear a lot of people say, I was about to leave the business or leave and do something else, and then they get that big break or that huge big job that changes everything. But you were literally on the way to the airport to leave New York?
Yes.
That you don't hear as much.
Yeah, I decided I was just, I needed to be doing television. And, you know, I had really good years up until 1978. And then 78 was awful. I decided to change everything and go to LA.
Wow.
So, I mean, so anyway, I had to come in an audition. And I first met Bill. I walked into this room and at Playwrights, and Billy was there. And I thought, like, this guy's nuts. I mean, I you know, and he told me I was singing in those days Jackie from Jacques Brel. And Bill, I think his first, as I started singing, he said, "Oh my God, not that song. I hate that song." and then he said, "And your hands are like all over the place." He said, "Just stand up on the piano." So I stood on the piano and I sang Jackie, and he told me to stop and sing anything else, and somehow I got the part. Wow.
And the relationship was never cantankerous again?
No, we always got along. It was just always easy. It was always just a sweet, marvelous adventure through all of those years.
Mary, we can see you.
One of the things that happened.
Unbelievably, when I was in high school, I went and saw it. What's the Michael Waller play you
Moon
were
Children.
In?
It was Moon Children.
I went and saw Moon Children in Boston, and someone with a high nasal voice said to someone else, "I'm going in tonight. I'm going in tonight."
Yeah.
And it was Chip Zien. And I realized this years later.
Yeah.
I saw him the night he went into
Moon Children. I was just telling somebody I got mugged at knife point in Boston on the way to the theater, the Charles Street Playhouse, and I had a totally inappropriate response because I thought they wanted my autograph. And I started laughing. It was completely, and I, you know, I it was a really bad thing, and my response was to laugh. And that's Bill saw that.
Yeah. Wait, speaking of inappropriate responses, Chip, would you just give us 2 seconds on the time you were on the plane and the engine blew up that I just saw posted?
That's on Facebook.
Just saw that on Facebook, too.
Yeah, that's a true story. I just thought of it because of the 777 that just had that problem. I was with Susie, my wife, and we were in London, and I was flying back from Heathrow, and about like an hour out from Heathrow over the Atlantic, I'm sitting next to an engine that just blew up. I mean, it was a massive explosion, and I was sitting right next to it. And as I say in that thing I put on Facebook, I always thought I was a go-to guy in an emergency. And what I found out is that I had an instinct to remove my clothing. I have no idea why, but it seemed like the only thing I could control at that is, and the pilot famous, he said, engine number, he came on about 20 minutes later, and the engine was gone. I mean, it was not there, 747. And he came on about 20 minutes later, and he said, like, engine number 3 is offline. And the flight attendants were running up and down the aisle. I said, it's 35,000 feet offline. Or it's not just offline, it's in the ocean. I mean, so that was the experience. And I was absolutely petrified, but I'm still here.
Did you survive? Okay, good. I just want to make sure that
I'm actually here. I got through it. So that was that story.
Here's a little in trousers, by the way, for those that want to remember what it looked like.
Great. Oh my God. I love that.
Speaking of disrobing, and Michael Rupert, how did you become the Marvin that we all know and love?
Well, March of the Falsettos was happening at Playwrights. I auditioned actually for Lapine, who was directing the show. And after what you said about doing his that Bill hated for his audition for In Trousers. After I auditioned for Lapine, Jim then the next day had me bring in every piece of music I knew, like a whole stack of my whole book of music, because he wanted to pick a song that Bill wouldn't hate, because I had to sing for Bill the next day. Some songs he doesn't like. So I ended up singing a Randy Newman tune. Sail Away, maybe? It was Randy Newman. And Lapine said, sing that. He likes Randy Newman. and I got involved at Playwright. And yeah.
You got to play.
And I got, and all during rehearsal, Chip kept mentioning to me very, very quietly, you know, I'm really Marvin.
I had one problem.
He kept saying to me during rehearsal, you know, I'm Marvin.
You know, I didn't know. I had to ask Bill what Wizard Going Down was all about. There's a song in Trousers, for those of you who might be watching. There's a song called Wizard Going Down. And I thought it meant that he was going down to Florida. I literally had no idea. I had no idea what we were talking or singing.
You're Jewish. Huh? You're the two Marvins.
Ah.
Back in the day. Michael, your connection is a little cray cray. I think you should log off and come back on. Are you on a laptop?
Yeah, I'm on a laptop.
It's weird. Connection is weird. I'm gonna log you off and then just log back on. It's just clicking. We're gonna bring in our doctor anyway. So we'll see you in a minute. So kick from studio by him. Okay, we're gonna go into many more shows right after this. We're gonna have a medical break from Dr. LaPook that we have every night. Chief medical correspondent from CBS. So everybody take a break. Perhaps go pee, reapply that blush.
And hopefully Michael will come back and it won't be clickety-clackety.
Yes. We'll see you soon, birthday boy. Chip, have a nice tip. Mary, your lighting.
We'll see you in a little bit.
Lighting is fierce. Here we are, direct from outside, Dr. John LaPook.
Happy birthday. Well, we spare no expense at Stars in the House. I'm in a parking. You sent me to a parking lot in San Diego. and you're seeing the sun setting. Over there, and this gorgeous tree, and a little
Southern
thing
California.
I like to call the moon. See the birds and the moon and the helicopter.
Yeah.
Anyway, all right, that was all green screen.
Exactly. thanks for coming on, even though you're traveling. So, Dr. John LaPook, James and I just went into a full panic because we saw some articles saying there's a new variant in New York that's a nightmare. Can you maybe calm us down at all?
Okay, so these variants are here. We know that there's a UK variant that was first found in the United Kingdom, and it seems to be able to spread more quickly, like about maybe 40-50% more quickly than the wild type, the original one. It actually hopped over the Atlantic and is here. There's a type that's in South Africa and Brazil that seems a little, both able to be a little stickier in terms of its ability to attach to human cells and also maybe be a little bit resistant to the vaccines that are out there. So this is because RNA viruses, which is what the SARS-CoV-2 is, they replicate, and when they replicate, they can make mistakes. And if they make a mistake, it's called a mutation. And most of the mutations don't do anything. It's of no consequence. A couple of them can team up, one or more mutations, to form a virus that's a variant. And that may be nothing. But if it's a variant of concern, then that's the new thing you're hearing, VOC, a variant of concern. Then it's one of these new type of variants that we're concerned about. Now, amazingly, there is a international database that scientists all over the world are uploading the sequences of viruses into one big database. Mm. And everybody's analyzing that. It's like an international war room. So what happened is somebody on the West Coast took a look at some patterns that were going on in New York and said, even though he was in Caltech, he said, oh, look at that. There seems to be something popping up in New York. And then Dr. Ho up in at Columbia came up with something similar where he said, oh, there seems to be some variants that are in New York City. And they seem to be similar to what we're seeing in South Africa, some of the, you know, of the mutations that we're seeing there. It's nothing to panic about, but it is a warning for everybody, which is right now we're seeing a drop in cases. We're seeing a lull. You cannot get complacent. This is the time to really make sure we vaccinate everybody as quickly as possible, that we wear masks, that we do all the things, washing your hands and staying outdoors whenever we can, avoiding crowds, the whole thing, because we have an opportunity. We have a window now to really make a difference before these variants, before these mutations get ahead of us. Because what's going to happen is, and we already just heard today that Moderna is already developed a booster to take care of, to try to address some of these new variants.
Wow.
So if you remember Mad Magazine, Spy versus Spy versus Spy, which I always loved, you know, we change, it changes. It changes, but we're going to always be a little behind it. So the way to really try to crush it is with these masks. Right now, I'm doing just a regular shoot for CBS News. I've got a surgical mask on the inside. And then on the outside, I've got a double ply fabric mask, so that really.
Did you pass out?
It keeps it in place. It keeps it in place, because if I don't wear this, the problem is I've got these openings over here.
Yeah.
And there are clips that you can buy and all that. But the easiest thing is just get a cloth there. And then that makes the seal. The seal is very important. So if there ever was a time, you know, I was on the plane right out today, and in front of me, there was a woman who wasn't covering her nose. Two rows ahead of me, a guy who wasn't covering his nose. Oh, yeah. Over on the aisle across from me, a woman who wasn't covered. The mask wasn't covering the nose. I said something to the woman to my left.
Yeah.
And she gave me a look like I had just killed her cat. Or, wow. You know, it was like, and I can't, it really makes me crazy. And then I asked the steward, the flight attendant to say something to the woman in front of me, because I didn't want to start something. And she gave that same look. And everybody
out
there.
The same look to you, the flight attendant?
The woman gave the same look to the flight attendant. I can't believe you're bothering me. I mean, it kills me, because had the messaging been correct from the very beginning.
Very beginning.
This wouldn't be a political thing. It wouldn't be a look, this is my right. It would be like, I want to keep my child alive. I want my grandchildren to be able to go to school without worrying. I want the teacher. I want the grandmother. I mean, how this became something that it shouldn't have become is crushing. But in any case, here we are right now, folks. I think peer pressure, you don't want to get into a fight, but we've got to make it so that if you're not wearing that mask correctly, say something. If you see something, say something.
You're saying the more people that get COVID, the more chance there is to mutate. So it's important that no one gets COVID, so we don't keep getting mutations. Second of all, for the people that are like, the vaccine is dangerous because it was developed so quickly, your main point is the vaccine was developed basically 20 years ago. Am I right?
Yes, the vaccine is safe. I mean, that's one thing. Now we've got millions of people, right? People are doing, it's very, very safe. I think I heard like 4 cases of anaphylaxis, that serious reaction for 1 million people getting it. It's very, very safe. The issues are, is the vaccine changing so much that the vaccines are going to be less effective? The good news is all of the vaccines are 100% protective against hospitalization and death right now. They have varying efficacy against mild disease, moderate disease, but they're all, even Johnson & Johnson and the AstraZeneca and the Moderna and the Pfizer, and now we think Johnson & Johnson, they're all incredibly effective. So let's do belt and suspenders. We got to do that. Vaccine. We have to make sure there's vaccine equity, that people aren't, that every people of color, people who don't have money, people don't have pull, that they get it. We have to make sure that the rest of the world gets it, because otherwise there'll be mutations there that come boomerang, right, hit us right in the head, if you want to be selfish about it, but also they need to be protected. So this is the time where we step up. And so far, we haven't done that well in our national IQ-EQ test, but we can do it now. We can do it now. I know it.
All right. Thank you for cheering us up.
Yeah, we always love how you you do your best to end on a positive note, and you did not fail tonight.
All right. Good night, guys.
Thank you. Love you.
Yeah, we all love right. you. Bye, Dr. LaPook. I love that. How dedicated is he? Comes on while he's traveling.
I know.
Okay, let's bring on a couple more of our clowns.
I'll bring them back.
Yes.
And hopefully Michael's...
So here's the birthday boy himself. Hi, Bill Finn. All right. Blank-faced. Michael Rupert, let me see how your Wi-Fi is. 1, 2, 3. Michael Rupert.
So is this better?
It's better so far.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Good.
So yes to that. Okay. Let's bring on Set Them Sails, Mary Testa. Let us bring on the lovely Alison Frage. Let's bring on Marvin, the quote unquote real Marvin. Okay. So I have some clips I want to show.
Donations.
Oh, we got donations.
Did you send them?
No, I've not sent them to anybody.
Okay. So you go ahead and set that up.
Okay. So one thing I want to show. This is a moment. This is the baseball game. So Bill Finn, you know, I'm obsessed with Falsetto Land. I'm like, I literally think it's just one of the greatest musicals literally ever written, like ever. Why? How'd you come up with the idea of the baseball game? Why are you saying Jewish people can't play baseball? Did you ever see me play baseball? How did you know that I suck? Go.
Jewish people, except for my brother, I cannot play baseball. My brother was a brilliant baseball player.
So there's a good baseball player.
Really, this was an ode to him. I wanted to say, except for Michael Finn, in the ellipse.
Okay, I want to show this clip. It's so brilliant. And Ship, it's so funny because I so know it from the album, and your reaction to Barbara Walsh tapping you, it's like you're a crazy, like you're Francis Farmer being taken away to an institution. It's actually a hilarious acting moment. Here we go. Oh my God. Okay. So Michael Rupert, how did you feel after you created the role off Broadway? And then something 2 years later, they're like, ooh, by the way, we're going to Broadway with it. It's like everyone's dream.
How did I feel about that?
Yes.
It was great. I mean, you know, I it was great that we put the two shows together to go to Broadway, a March of the Falsetto and the Falsetto Land, you know. It was a kind of thing where we all just enjoyed being with each other so much. Mm. I think that it was a fun show to do, and it was great that it was really going to be seen by a wider audience. It was also exhausting for me. I mean, I just remember, I'm going to be tired all the time, you know. But here's what it was great.
It's two full musicals. And Bill Finn, whose idea was it to combine two shows together? Because normally sequels don't work. Bring Back Birdie was not a hit. Who decided to put them both on the same bill?
Couldn't hear you. Sorry.
Oh. Who decided to put both musicals together, March of Falsettos and Falsetto Land?
We always intended to do that.
Really?
In fact, Falsetto Land was not going to be its own play. We were going to do both them, but then Lapine decided they were going to kill us if we just did a second act here.
Oh, wow.
Oh, so interesting. And then how did you decide to add lesbian characters? Again, a big first on Broadway. Is it the first lesbian character? I feel it is the first lesbian character on Broadway, isn't it?
Well, I wanted to, when it was finally done, I wanted to give the two ladies from In Trousers roles. So that's how we got the lesbians.
And yet, Mary Testa, you weren't playing with the lesbians.
No, I said no. I had concert work that was going to pay me a lot of money, and I didn't, you know, it was Bill, it was too small a role for me.
Were you going to be Dr. Charlotte or Cordelia?
I was going to be
Dr. Charlotte.
Dr. Charlotte. Yeah, it was too small.
Interesting. You'd sound great on it. Here's here's the classic entrance.
Such Heather great, and Janet were fantastic.
Such a great entrance, man. I have one more "How did you think" of moment because I love it so much. How did you go into the Pesach song in the middle of Chips, Everyone Hates His Parents? It's such an amazing tip of the hat to Jews. Bill Finn, I don't know if you're sleeping, reading something.
Oh, I didn't know what else to do.
Well, so, eye contact is good.
No, I think you mean writing the song.
You know what else to do? I mean, what does that mean? How did you I want to know the writing process.
It just seemed funny to me.
Okay, well, that is true. It is hilarious. Here it is. It's so perfect for anyone that's been at a Seder. It is hilarious.
Jason, I am on Chicago Grande, Jason. I am Venus Cutante and Venus Fuente and Nauseatus and Mimi Triumphosian Dianu.
I was so young.
You know, he does it well.
It is so brilliant. Okay, Michael Rupert, how's your sounding now? Let's hear.
Yeah, is it okay? Is it all right?
Yeah.
It's weird, yeah.
It's weird, yeah. It wasn't like that earlier during soundcheck.
Yeah.
It hesitates.
Yes, it hesitates.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right.
I want to talk
also
a little bit about
my camera is also, you know, kind of doing weird stuff. So it may be just the Wi-Fi down here that's just not working right now.
Yeah,
it's weird. It's very odd. All right, I want to talk a little bit about a new brain, which some of us all got to do together. Who do I have here? Oh, here I have Arthur himself, Mr. Norman Orell Lewis.
Hello. How are you?
Hi, Norm.
Hi,
Norm.
What's
happening?
Norm. How you doing? Can you hear me?
Yes, Queen. Okay. Hey, Bill, Bill Finn, tell everybody how you came up with the idea of a new brain.
I had a brain thing. And it's pretty autobiographical.
It basically happened to you, but just not with music.
It happened with music in my head, but otherwise not music, no.
But were you actually at a restaurant and, like, passed out?
Yes, in fact.
Wow.
So scary, man. And was it one of those things that when you got sick, you were like, oh, my God, I have wasted my life not writing enough music, like the character thinks?
Yeah. Hmm.
So then you started writing tons of shows after that, am I right?
I wrote a little quicker for a while.
You wrote what for a while?
I wrote a little quicker.
You did write quicker. By the way, who's
it's
actually
hard for me to write?
Wait, who's
I write all the time.
Who's in an People aviary or a journal?
I have birds. They're
it's
talking.
You?
But I'm in the other room, so let me shut the door.
Okay. That's what that was. No, I was trying to figure out.
I thought he was sleeping and he had four sparrows living with him. I can't on every single level. Okay, so Norm Lewis, did you know you came to Broadway so late in your life. Did you know any of Bill Finn's work or did you first learn it when you actually got the score to New Brain?
I got introduced to Bill's work through, God rest his soul, Jason Upsall. He said, we got to go see this show. I knew him through friends of friends. And he said, we got to go see this show, Falsetto Land. I'm like,
Who was it?
Jason.
What was the name?
Jason Upsall. Jason Upsall.
Opshal.
And he, when I got here, he was like, you need to see this show. And so I went with him and was blown away and loved Bill's work ever since then.
But that was your first show, was New Brain, right?
My first show, well, you know what? I think I got introduced to Bill, and I'm not sure of the correct time. Can you guys hear me? I'm not sure if the mic is.
Yeah, I can hear you. Great.
I
can hear you.
I think I got introduced to him from the workshop of a show called Muscle. And and then from there, I got a new brain, I think, if I can get the timeline right. But
right.
So I auditioned for Bill and also James Lapine, and they remembered me, and I came in for a new brain. And I actually got the show, but I was going to play a different part. And then at the same week, I got All My Children. So I ended up taking All My Children instead of being in the original company of the show.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. And then if people don't know, Chris got sick. Chris was playing Arthur, got sick, and then right. You took over. How long did you have? Because you did the album first. I remember we were doing a benefit together and you were learning the album. How long did you have to learn?
That was the first time he ever did.
Yeah.
The first time he ever sang it was on the album.
On the album, yeah. So I did. I had 2 days to learn the music. And I saw the show one night. I had the music with me. And then like 2 days later, we're in the studio and we're recording. And so if you listen closely, I don't know if anyone else can hear it, but you might be able to hear pages turning because I'm the only one that didn't know the show.
Norm was like letter perfect. It was unbelievable. He hadn't met us, really.
No, hadn't met anybody.
And he just came to the studio and did magnificent and wonderful.
God bless you. It's funny because I got to sing that iconic song now, but when I listen to it, I can hear me going, I'd rather be sailing. You know what I mean? Like, instead of actually feeling it, because I wanted to make sure I got the notes right. But, yeah.
Well, Normie, you got too comfortable with it, because I have one of my favorite clips. When I used to conduct the show, when I used to conduct New Brain, which was like around once a week, Norm started adding an extra riff for me, and I actually found the clip of the riff. It's supposed to be, maybe we'll laugh out loud, maybe we'll dance, maybe we'll dance, we will sing. That's it. Sing was the note, and Norm added a full sassafras, and I found a clip of it. This is Norm, too comfortable.
Well, I got permission from Bill to do it. So.
Oh, I was about to ask you.
You did? I always thought you did it secretly. All right, well, here it is. I love it.
Would you ever I'm inviting you to sleep in my arms. Maybe we'll laugh too loud. Maybe we'll dance and you will sing. Maybe we'll smile at all the pleasures. Sex and eating often bring. Maybe we'll say no words. Just saying nothing is sublime. Maybe we'll read a book.
Gorgeous. Why did that say evaluation copy?
I was going to ask the same thing.
I just found it online.
On yeah.
It was on YouTube. Mm-hmm. Who's evaluating it?
Yeah. I don't know. That's what it said.
I know. It's so bizarre.
But go ahead. I just want to say that I don't know if I've ever publicly said thank you to each and every one of you that were involved with that, but Chip was so welcoming. He was always giving me crap in the room, but I knew that he loved me because of that. Mary Testa was so patient with me. It's because she was the homeless woman in the show. And so she guided me throughout the show. So I always relied on her and would squeeze her hand.
Aww.
Thank you. Thank you, guys.
Norm.
That's great.
But it's weird that Chip kept telling you that he was the real Marvin.
Yeah. I didn't do it in that. I did try to sing some riffs. I tried to sing Mary's riffs before she sang them. And then she would switch to something else. She could always be. I wasn't good at that.
I have a great clip, Mary, of you doing your big song from A New Brain. You sound fantastic on it. Speaking of sassy riffs,
is it an evaluation clip?
No, I think it's regular B-roll.
Oh. Where your kindness begins. Please, folks, do not spend time with me. I won't ask you to treat me like your mother. I'm not asking for sympathy.
Me and my Texas dirt. I was obsessed with being as dark as possible.
Mary, when you did the rehearsals for New Brain versus way back when you had started with Bill, had his process changed as far as his writing or rehearsal process or anything?
Yeah, it was different because I was dealing with, you know, a show like Lapine was the director, you know, in the days when we started, Bill was the director. So, you know, it was
and
a different
also, kind I had of... gotten better.
Also, you had gotten better? Yeah, I guess you better. Had. I mean, you know, it was this, it was learning the stuff. I wasn't in any of the workshops of A New Brain.
Right.
So I wasn't in it from the beginning, but I did do the Lincoln Center. So.
Right.
Anyway, I guess you could say it was different.
It was definitely, and it was rehearsal during the day. That was the difference.
It was during the day, exactly. We didn't work till 4 a.m.
And Bill, tell everybody how you write music, because I've been one of your transcribers. Talk about your system.
Oh, well, I ABCs are ABCs.
He writes the lyrics. Yeah, he writes the lyrics and he handwrites the notes on top of it. And then you listen to him playing it and singing it, and then you write down what he did. I did that with, I think I did the Royal Family song I did for you, and maybe I did Sitting Becalmed in the Lee of Cuddy Hunk. I remember writing it out for you. It's a hard, who does it for you now? It's a lot of work. It's hard. Who does it for you now?
Depending.
I guess I have to.
Yeah, depending.
One more thing. Speaking
hold,
of a new,
hold on. Yes. So before we do that, we have more donations coming in. This is.
Oh, did Michael read his yet?
Michael, you I don't know.
Michael, I has sent he? You. I just realized I sent you donations a while ago. Sorry. Check your iPhone, Michael.
I didn't know.
I sent you a tag. It's like a picture of tech of donations.
But you can keep sending them in. I'll send them to Norm next. But starsinthehouse.com or text fund 2020 to 56512. Forward that receipt to donations at starsinthehouse.com. And Michael, we'll see if you got him.
Yeah, see how crazy you sound.
Oh, yeah. There yeah. We go. Want me to read it? Yeah.
Yes, please.
How's my sound? Is it okay?
It's fine-ish.
Fine-ish. Robert and Stephen, $50. Finn and his cohorts have given us so many years of pleasure back to discovering the LP of trousers. And a special shout out to Mary Testa, who was kind enough to give our stage obsessed collegiate niece an interview last week.
Oh, yes. Oh, wow.
You remember that?
I do.
Then there's some, yeah. And then Samara, $37. I love this, all caps, exclamation point. The soundtrack of my life. And it's two. Happy birthday, Seth and Bill. More exclamation points. And Tom in Chicago, $100. Bill Finn's music changed my life. And this reunion of Finn royalty is joyful. Exclamation point. Thank you. Thank you so much for donating.
Lovely. And thank you, Bill, for all the music. And who got the second set?
Well, we're gonna wait on that. So go ahead.
Okay. Larry. Okay, Larry, if I donate. Okay, Larry, you have to forward your donation. Exactly. Forward a donation to donations at starsinthehouse.com. Read the ticker tape going across the bottom.
There you go.
I have one more thing to play, and then I got to bring in our last guest. My ex-boyfriend, Aaron, knew A New Brain really well. And to this day, whenever we interrupt each other, we'll be like, nobody asked based on this moment.
Okay.
Nobody asked my opinion.
Anyway.
Penny. Yay.
Yay, Penny.
Yes.
Just out of the blue, and it was always so loud. Penny Fuller being fabulous. Okay, I have another fabulous Bill Finn singer to bring on, who I saw when she starred amazingly at the Public Theater in Romance at Hard Times. Please welcome Ms. Lillias White.
Hi, y'all. Yeah. Hi.
Hey, beautiful.
Hi. Hi, Norm. Mary Testa.
Hey, Lil. How are you? How we you go doing? Back a ways, Lillias and I. Yes. I was Lillias' understudy in Barnum.
Yes.
Wow. And you guys are now wearing matching glasses.
Yes.
Yes, darling. The better to see you with, my dear.
And the reading glasses. I have to wear them when I do these things.
It looks great. It's so cute. Okay, so Lillias, tell everybody about the show you did, which I first saw with Pat of the Pwn back in the day, and then I saw your version.
I did Romance in Hard Times. I'd never seen it, but I liked it because I
need your cube.
Huh?
I'm sorry. I'll be right back.
I liked it because I liked the syncopation of the music. I liked the variance and the intervals, and I loved the story about this little woman who is determined to have the world be better before she lets loose with this baby. So she holds the baby for 27 months. And I got to sing some of the most beautiful music. And, you know, last time I saw you, last time I talked to you, Bill Finn, happy birthday, by the way. Billy, can you hear me?
Yeah, he's just blank faced.
Oh, okay, no, yeah.
All right, pay attention.
I can hear you.
All right,
can pay you attention. Hear me?
Yeah, you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday, Seth.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I
we
hear
can
you.
Hear you.
Can you hear me?
Okay, fine.
Okay, fine. So the last time
thank
we talked,
your birthday quick, greeting.
What?
Thank you for your birthday greeting.
Aww. You're very welcome. But the last greeting that I got from you, sir.
Come on.
Was you calling me to tell me that I was too old to play Henny.
Okay. You remember a lot of horrible stories, Lillias.
Now, this one was funny because he was coming at me with the love. I felt the love in there somewhere. It was in there. But when you said, Lillias, you know, we're doing your show up at Barrington. I said, yeah, I read about it in the paper. He says, well, you know, you're my favorite, but you're too old. I said, well, thank you so much, William, for calling to tell me that. I disagree with you, by
you
the way.
Said
I
don't love. Disagree with you.
Because that character.
Whatever.
Yeah, whatever.
Sophie
that character, she could be an older
us.
Woman. Who's that woman in the Bible who waited till she was 100 and some years to have a baby?
Rebecca?
Yeah, whoever she was. So, William, you know, I'm perfect age right now.
You're perfectly aged.
Lillias, Bill always tells it like it is. I won't say who, but one of my friends, Bill said to one of my friends, hey, the two of us should go on The Biggest Loser. That's a TV show for morbidly obese people. And she was like, I don't want to go on that show. But I won't say who it was, but Bill's very direct, and we appreciate him for that.
Well, I enjoy doing that show. I love being at the Public. We had an incredible cast of people. Clevant Derricks, Lawrence Clayton.
Michael Mandel.
Oh, Michael just passed, didn't
yeah.
he?
Yeah.
And Lawrence did too.
Lawrence passed too. But we had James Stovall. God bless him.
Oh, my God. James Stovall was in it.
Melody Savage, Victor Cook. And a very young Billy Porter.
Oh, that's wow. right.
Right. Alex Corey. Alex Corey, John Sloman. I know I'm forgetting somebody, but we had an incredible cast of people. And it was at the Public. It was well attended. And we honestly all thought that Joe Papp was going to take it to Broadway because that's where it should have gone. But alas, he didn't. But now, here's the opportunity, William Finn.
Yes. Yes,
it is. Here's the opportunity to put me in the show as the oldest woman having had the longest pregnancy in the history of pregnancy.
It's biblical.
Totally.
It's what?
Biblical.
Yeah, let's make it biblical for real. I could be her.
Yeah, Bill, this is basically an audition. We all want a gig.
Right.
What do you got? Head goes down, falls head asleep. Down. Oh, immediately.
Are you asking me?
Yeah, you.
We all want a job. What do you got, job
what
wise?
Are you asking?
We need jobs. What do you got?
I have got a few songs, like two song cycles.
Oh.
I've written the lyrics with two of my students. Deborah Abramson and Danny Garcetti. And they're really good.
How about we do a revival of Romance in Hard Times with everybody right here?
That'd be great.
Are you ready for that, Bill?
I'm ready.
Okay. All right. When you get the call, you know what to do, right? Right.
Mm-hmm. Mary, you've been quoted. We need jobs. What do you got?
Yeah. Well, you know, it would be nice to do another Bill Finn show.
Absolutely. Oh, yes.
We would love that.
We'd all love that.
Well, you know what's interesting is that everyone's so connected. I've worked with everyone in this group here. And, Bill is the center point, obviously. Happy birthday to both you and Seth. But I just want to say that Alison and I were roaches in a show one time. Yeah.
Roaches in love.
Roaches in love.
What?
We were roaches in a show in
what
love.
Show?
We don't want to say, but anyway. And I have to say that Michael Rupert, I didn't know him, but I saw him, which I didn't realize I saw you when, I hate to say this line, but when I was a kid, you were in one of my favorite movies. The tennis shoes, the computer who wore tennis shoes.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Yes. Because you put that out
to
there.
The film, and I was guys. Like, oh my Brilliant God. Film.
But you and I were the same age then. That's what I just want to say that. But no, but it's just great that how we're all connected, in this industry, and there's so much love in this tiny little room right here. And so I just had to say that.
Aww. Here's the photo from back then.
Oh my goodness.
Oh wow. Oh.
That's wow.
Mr. Bungie.
That was New Brain.
Is that?
Is Malcolm.
Is that Kristen Chenoweth?
It's Kristen Chenoweth.
Keith Byron Kirk. And I can't, John Jellison. Yes.
As the doctor. We don't have to. And Malcolm.
And that was me in the frog hat.
Yes.
I think we knew that. I think we knew that.
Yeah, that we knew.
The frog helmet, I believe I called it.
All right, so wait, we got to complete the audition. Lillias, you are going to haul out a song tonight. How's that sound system?
Oh, let's see.
Want to get the dog out?
No, I can go. You got it. Let's warm up those pipes. Me.
Oh, Popeye. All right, let's see here.
Okay, I'm going to mute everybody.
Things come slowly. When they finally come, they come too slowly. Very soon we're blowing this old town. If I'm wrong, then knock me down. Kid, be funny. Learn to tell a joke and kid be funny. Say the things to make your mama smile. I forgot the other words. Kid, I think I like your style. Really, kid, I like your style. Am I dreaming? I'm not dreaming. Kid, your moment grows. You must bring this waiting to a close. I'll go about my daily business. Happiness will spread. 6 p.m. and you'll be home in bed. When the wrong part, that's enough for me. For me, yeah. I laughing here. I'll keep going, and you'll be home in bed. Kiss my almost perfect husband, vow you welcome free. Have a place to rest a restless head. That's enough for me. Perfect. I want it perfect. But if it's not, that's still okay. I'll still play the happy bride with my husband by my side. I'll swoon and have my baby soon. Are you ready? Kid, get ready. Kid, your moment grows. You must bring this waiting to a close. Come on out and meet the people. Girls on mama's knees. From now on, the bad will be ignored. That's enough for me. For me. For me.
Oh my God. It's been a little while, so some of the words got away from me.
You still got it.
Yay. And so that was one of the first, that was the first major award that I got in the theater was from that show.
Wow.
Oh my God.
Really?
Wow.
You still got it.
Thank you.
Ow.
You heard that, Billy, right?
Bill, what's your reaction, dear?
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
You can't hear us?
You can't hear us?
What is your reaction to Lillias singing?
I can't hear you. Okay, I could do it. It was good when you remembered the words.
Billy, do you remember the words?
Oh,
only some of them.
Okay.
I sent you some donations. Could you read them?
Check what? Your fam. Mary Testa has got some donations.
I sent them to Mary, actually, Norm.
What?
Yeah, Mary.
Check your fam.
What do I look at? What did I look for?
Text. A text from us.
Oh, okay. No, I don't have anything from you.
Uh-oh.
Oh, I do. Yeah, I do, I do, I do. Greg from Illinois, $20. Thanks for this great show. Bruce Coughlin, $103. Gave money because I love all these people. Happy birthday, William and Seth. Lori from L.A., $25. Curtis Hay, $25. For Michael and our time together on Three Guys. For Mary Testa in Lucky Stiff, one of the funniest performances I've ever seen. Oh, that's very sweet. For Bill Finn and the catharsis of the Falsettos trilogy, thank you. Oh.
Beautiful.
This was so nice.
I love that.
Bill, I want to publicly thank you for giving me two iconic songs. People always say that they love A New Brain, and the one that I really, really love is Anytime. I'll Be There. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I love singing your song. So thank you for that.
Yeah. You guys,
God bless.
Such a great night. I'm such a fan of all of you. So excited to have you all on the same screen. Thank you. And Bill, thanks for writing such brilliant, timeless, classic music, yes. Man.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Happy birthday, brother.
Absolutely. Happy birthday, Billy.
Thank you.
Happy birthday, Happy birthday, Billy.
And here's some many more.
This was wonderful. It was wonderful to see you all.
Yes.
It's great to see you too, honey. What kind of birds do you have, Mary?
I have two parakeets. They're in the other room.
Okay.
I have a little menagerie. I have a dog and I have two parakeets.
I got a dog and a cat. I'm surprised they didn't jump up here because they all were
crazy. I know. Mine's been going in and out of the door. But anyway. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you very much. It was great.
So, William Finn, just remember what Mary Testa said.
Yeah, that we are all jobs. Looking.
We're working. We're ready to work.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. I will call you on your birthday, Bill.
All right, Seb, you playing us out?
I'll play out.
All right. Bye,
I love
everyone.
You all. I got to go.
Thanks, guys. Really happy birthday.
Thank you.